Dear students, today I will teach you a chapter, Indigo, by Louis Fisher. First of all, know about the author. Louis Fisher was born in Philadelphia. He was a volunteer in the British Army, and he made his career as a journalist and wrote for the New York Times. The chapter Indigo is an extract from his book, The Life of Mahatma Gandhi. And the book has been reviewed as one of the best books ever written on Gandhi by Times Educational Supplement. Now, if I talk about the title, Indigo. Indigo is a commercial crop. Actually, this crop is very significant because it is used for obtaining indigo color, a purplish blue color. And the whole chapter revolves around it. In this chapter, you will see the role of Mahatma Gandhiji. Mahatma Gandhiji is known as the father of the nation, and he was the one of the foremost leaders of the Indian freedom struggle. He led the freedom struggle movement also. The indigo crop is at the center because of this crop only, the sharecroppers, the Indian peasants, the peasants of Champaran, they had to suffer much at the hands of the British planters. And Mahatma Gandhiji solved their problem, and he helped these peasants socially and economically. So today I will teach this chapter to you. Now I am starting. When I first visited Gandhi in 1942 at his ashram in Sevagram in central India, he said, "I will tell you how it happened that I decided to ask the departure of the British. It was in 1917. Louis Fisher, the writer, visited Gandhiji in 1942 at his ashram. And where was his ashram? In Sevagram. And that time, Gandhiji told the writer that in 1917, he decided to throw the British government out of the country. Further, he had gone to the December 1916 annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. There were 2,301 delegates and many visitors. During the proceedings, Gandhiji recounted, "A peasant came up to me, looking like any other peasant in India, poor and emaciated, and said, 'I am Rajkumar Shukla, I am from Champaran, and I want you to come to my district.' Gandhiji had never heard of the place. It was in the foothills of the towering Himalayas, near the Kingdom of Nepal." In 1916, in the December of 1916, Gandhiji attended annual convention, annual agreement, and annual conference of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. So where was it held? In Lucknow. And that time there were 2,301 delegates. Delegates means representative. And many visitors who were attending this conference. And during the proceedings, when the conference was going on, Gandhiji recounted. Recounted means recalled. He remembered. "A peasant came up to me looking like any other peasant in India, and I am from Champaran, and said, 'I am Rajkumar Shukla, I am from Champaran.'" Gandhiji recalled that in 1916, when he was attending a conference in Lucknow, a peasant came up to him and told him that he was Rajkumar Shukla. He was looking very poor and emaciated, very lean and thin, and he told Gandhiji that he was Rajkumar Shukla and he was from Champaran, and he wanted him to take to his district, means he wanted to take Gandhiji to Champaran. Champaran is the district of Bihar. Gandhiji had never heard of this place. Actually, Gandhiji did not know about the place. Where was Champaran? It was in the foothills of the towering Himalayas near the kingdom of Nepal. Another paragraph. Under an ancient arrangement, the Champaran peasants were sharecroppers. Rajkumar Shukla was one of them. He was illiterate but resolute. He had come to the Congress session to complain about the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar, and somebody had probably said, speak to Gandhi. Now, we will learn about an ancient arrangement. What was the contract? Arrangement means contract. What was the contract? The Champaran peasants were sharecroppers, and Rajkumar Shukla was one of them. Rajkumar Shukla was illiterate but resolute. Resolute means very firm, very determined. Actually, all the peasants were working as sharecroppers. Sharecroppers means who work as a tenant on the lands of the others. So they were working as sharecroppers. Rajkumar Shukla was one of them. He was illiterate but resolute, very firm, determined. How can you say that he was resolute? He had come to the Congress session to complain about the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar. He came to Lucknow to complain about the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar. They were the victim of landlord system in Bihar. And perhaps somebody had told him that Gandhiji would solve their problem. So he wanted to meet Gandhiji, take him to Champaran and get their problem solved. Now, next paragraph. Gandhiji told Shukla he had an appointment in Kanpur and was also committed to go to other parts of India. Shukla accompanied him everywhere. Then Gandhi returned to his ashram near Ahmedabad. Shukla followed him to the ashram. For four weeks, he never left Gandhiji's side. So this is his determination. He followed Gandhiji everywhere. He did not leave Gandhiji's side. And 4 weeks, he never left Gandhiji's side. Fix a date, he begged. He told Gandhiji, he requested Gandhiji that he wanted a date from him. He wanted him to take to Champaran. So impressed by sharecropper's tenacity and story, Gandhiji said, I have to be in Calcutta on such a such date. Come and meet me and take me from there. So when Gandhiji saw this sharecropper's determination, tenacity, insistence, Gandhiji told him to meet him in Calcutta on a particular date and ask him to come there and meet him there and take him from there. So months passed. Shukla was sitting on his haunches at the appointed spot in Calcutta when Gandhi arrived. He waited till Gandhi was free. Then the two of them boarded a train for the city of Patna in Bihar. There Shukla led him to the house of a lawyer named Rajendra Prasad, who later became president of Congress Party and of India. Rajendra Prasad was out of town, but the servants knew Shukla as a poor yeoman who pestered their master to help the indigo sharecroppers. So they let him stay on the grounds with his companion. Gandhi, whom they took to be another peasant, Gandhi was not permitted to draw water from the well, lest some drops from his bucket pollute the entire source. How did they know that he was not an untouchable? So Shukla waited for Gandhiji in Calcutta at the appointed spot in Calcutta. And when Gandhiji arrived, he was waiting for Gandhiji till Gandhiji was free. Then both of them boarded a train for the city of Patna. In Patna, Shukla took him to the house of Dr. Rajendra Prasad. Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who later became the president of the Congress Party and India also. He was the first president of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad. He was a lawyer. Actually, when Gandhiji and Rajkumar Shukla reached to Rajendra Prasad's house, he was out of town, he was not there. And the servants of Dr. Rajendra Prasad did not know Gandhiji. They knew only Rajkumar Shukla because he used to go there. So when they saw another person with Rajkumar Shukla, they thought that he was also a peasant. So they let him stay on the grounds with his companion. They did not offer him seat. They did not ask him to sit at proper place. So they let them stay on the grounds. They thought that he was another peasant because he was accompanying Rajkumar Shukla. And Gandhiji was not permitted to draw water from the well because they thought that he would be an untouchable and he would spoil the water. So he was not allowed to take water from the well also. Then Gandhiji decided to go to Muzaffarpur. Actually, why did he want to go to Muzaffarpur first? Because it was en route to Champaran. It was on the route to Champaran. So that he would obtain more complete information about conditions than Shukla was capable of imparting. Means he wanted to get more information than the Shukla would give to him. Imparting means to give. He accordingly sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kripalani of Arts College in Muzaffarpur. So Gandhiji sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kripalani. Who was J.B. Kripalani? He was a professor of Arts College in Muzaffarpur, whom he had seen at Tagore's Shantiniketan School. Actually, Mahatma Gandhi had already met him in Tagore's Shantiniketan School. The train arrived at midnight, 15 April 1917. Kripalani was waiting at the station with the last body of students. When Gandhiji reached to the station, J.P. Kripalani was waiting for him at the station with a large body of students. There were so many students with him. So Gandhiji stayed there for 2 days in the home of Professor Malkani. In Muzaffarpur, Gandhiji stayed for 2 days in the home of Professor Malkani. Who was Professor Malkani? He was a teacher in government school. Very important point is here, it was an extraordinary thing in those days. What was extraordinary in those days? Gandhiji commented, for a government professor to harbor a man like me. Means it was very difficult for a government servant to give shelter to a man like Gandhiji. Me means here Gandhiji. In smaller localities, the Indians were afraid to show sympathy for advocate of home rule. Actually, Gandhiji was the advocate of home rule. He wanted the British to go out of India and follow, and he wanted that we should advocate home rule, we should adopt home rule, we should adopt Indian things only. And people in the small localities, the Indians were afraid to show sympathy. They could not show sympathy to the advocates of home rule because people were afraid of the British government. And Gandhiji did not want British rule in India. So it was very difficult for Professor Malkani, a government servant, to give shelter to Gandhiji. The news of Gandhiji's advent and of the nature of his mission spread quickly through Muzaffarpur and to Champaran. Means as soon as people came to know that Gandhiji has reached to Muzaffarpur, sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on foot and by conveyance to see their champion. So all these sharecroppers from Champaran, when they came to know that Gandhiji had arrived to Muzaffarpur, they wanted to see their champion because they thought that he would rescue them from this difficult situation. And by conveyance to see their champion, Muzaffarpur lawyers called on Gandhiji to brief him, and all the lawyers of Muzaffarpur, they also came to meet Gandhiji, called on, met. They frequently represented peasants groups in court. They told him about their cases and reported the size of their fee. These lawyers informed Gandhiji about the cases which were pending in the courts, because these lawyers were leading the cases of these peasants, and they told about their cases and about the size of their fee also. When Gandhiji came to know about the size of their fee, Gandhiji chided the lawyers for collecting big fee from the sharecroppers. He said, "I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to the law courts. Taking such cases to the courts does little good. Where the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken, law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from fear." So Gandhiji chided them, scolded them, the lawyers. Why did they scold the lawyers? Why did they chide the lawyers? Why did he chide the lawyers? Because they were collecting big fee from the sharecroppers. And he told that he had come to the conclusion that they should stop going to the law courts, because going to the courts is doing very little good for the peasants. It was of no use going to the courts again and again, where the peasants are so struck, so crushed and fear-stricken, where there is too much fear among the peasants. Law courts are useless for them. The real relief for them is to be free from fear. So Gandhiji suggested that these peasants should be made free from the fear first. The going to the courts will not make any solution to them. It is better to make them free from the fear. Most of the arable land in the Champaran district was divided into large states owned by Englishmen and worked by Indians. The chief commercial crop was indigo. The landlords compelled all tenants to plant 3/20 or 15% of their holdings with indigo and surrender the entire indigo harvest as rent. This was done by long-term contract. A very important point of this chapter is there was a contract between the sharecroppers and the British planters, British landlords. Most of the arable land, agricultural land in the Champaran district was divided into large states, and they were owned, these states means large plants which were owned by the Englishmen, by the British planters, and worked by Indian tenants. And who worked on them? Land was owned by the Englishmen, and the workers were Indians. They were caste tenants. And the chief commercial crop was indigo. Which crop was grown on that land? Commercial crop, indigo. The landlords compelled all tenants to plant 3/20 or 15% of their holding with indigo. It was compulsory for all the tenants to grow indigo crop on the 15% of their land and surrender the entire indigo harvest as rent. And these peasants had to surrender the whole crop of indigo to the British planters, and it was as a rent. This was done by long-term contract, and it was a contract between the peasants and the British planters. Presently, the landlords learned that the Germany had developed synthetic indigo. They thereupon obtained agreements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. Now, a very big turn came here. The landlords, the British planters, came to know that Germany had developed synthetic indigo. So they thought that they should get the indigo from the Germany instead of asking the peasants to grow the indigo in their fields, because they were not getting more profit from here. So they asked him that to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. The sharecropping arrangement was irksome to the peasants, and many signed willingly. Those who resisted engaged lawyers. The landlords hired trucks. Meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the irritated peasants, who had signed and they wanted their money back. Actually, the British planters cheated the peasants. When they came to know that they could get better indigo and synthetic indigo from Germany, they cheated the peasants, saying that they were releasing them from the 15% arrangement. Actually, it was their trick. And in the beginning, because many of the peasants were illiterate, they signed willingly because they thought that the sharecropping arrangement was very irksome, very tiresome. So they signed willingly. There were some others who resisted, who opposed. Those who engaged lawyers, the landlords hired thugs. So they hired the middlemen, they hired the people who forced the pigeons to sign. Meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the illiterate pigeons, and very soon the illiterate pigeons also came to know about the trick of the British planters, and they wanted their money back. And at this point, Gandhiji arrived in Champaran, and this was the point. It was the point of time when Gandhiji reached to Champaran. So in this video, I have told about how why did Rajkumar Shukla want Gandhiji to go to come to the Champaran, and what was the long-term contact between the British planters and the pigeons, and how did Gandhiji reach to Champaran, and at what point Gandhiji arrived in Champaran, and the purpose of Gandhiji's to reach to Champaran was to grant justice to the pigeons of Champaran. In the next video, I will teach you further. Thanks for watching video. Thank you and have a nice day.